Jim Earl's on the line via FaceTime. Hello, Jim.
Hello, David Feldman. It's been a long time since we talked.
How are you, sir? We're rolling, by the way.
Oh, okay. Well, it's 77 degrees here in Los Angeles.
Okay.
That's pretty neat.
Uh-huh. What are you doing? Are you in front of a computer? I hear, like, crunching sounds.
I'm here in my car right now because I left the place where I'm sleeping. And I'm at the Los Angeles Bakery on Pasadena Street near downtown Los Angeles.
Ah, okay. So
great. Yeah, go ahead.
Jim Earl, you're blonde?
Kind of.
Yeah. You have a grandfather who met Adolf Hitler.
My uncle did.
Oh, your uncle met Adolf Hitler.
Yeah, Uncle Bill.
Uncle Bill. Yeah. And was Mr. French with Uncle Bill at the time?
Mr. French? Who's Mr. French?
Mr. French and Uncle Bill. You lived with Buffy.
Oh, that. I did live with Buffy, and then Buffy threw me out.
Uh-huh. You and your sister were orphaned. You had an older sister named Sissy, and Uncle Bill took you in with
Mr. French. That's a different family. I wish I was so lucky, because then I'd have plenty of methamphetamines and other kind of heroin that Buffy could get for me.
That's right. And then Uncle Bill could lend you the tailpipe.
Is that what happened, Uncle Bill?
Yeah. Didn't end too well for Uncle Bill.
Well, that's why they called it a family affair then.
And there were two Mr. Frenches.
There were two Mr. Frenches?
Yes, there was Sebastian Cabot, and then there was the insurance adjuster from To Catch a Thief, who replaced Sebastian Cabot. What are you doing in the car that you're making these noises that are...
No, I'm sorry. I think it's probably the iPhone and the reception.
Ah.
A lot of, you know, the cops, a lot of people listening in on your conversations here in Los Angeles. The LAPD is big on that.
Yeah, and it's nice to see that you've matured and you're calling them cops now.
The fuzz? I used to call them the fuzz.
Yes. That's when you had a blonde afro and used to raise a fist and say solid.
Solid. Now I just say there is iron in your words. And it is a good day to die. Because I'm Native American now.
How did you make the switch?
How did I make the switch? You know, well, homelessness does that to you. So I've been sleeping in a Hogan down here on Broadway near the City Hall and selling pupusas.
So your Uncle Bill, that's how they pronounce Uncle Bill on
right.
Family.
He also met Von Hindenburg.
Wow.
The same afternoon, in the same meeting.
And what, okay, so what year was this?
It was 1928, I believe.
And what was your Uncle Bill doing in Germany?
Well, his roommate and good friend until they both died in the last 10 years, by the way, in their mid-90s. They were roommates at Stanford.
Mm-hmm.
And his roommate.
They had a Nazi exchange program that I think is still going at Stanford.
Well, yes, I think Hoover initiated it.
Mm-hmm. His roommate, your Uncle Bill was going to Stanford.
Yeah, and his roommate, whose last name was Baumgartner, still had German relatives in Berlin. And so they decided to have a little summer vacation out there in Berlin in 1928.
Which was not a bad time to be in Berlin.
No. Yeah, well, that place was thriving. Lots of good cafes.
Mm-hmm.
Lots of excitement. People were out in the streets, energized, you know, that kind of thing. You know, it was a real ground-up movement. It was the grassroots.
Uh-huh. And so what did he remember? Like, where were they? And Hitler pulled... Hitler, I remember you told me Hitler was impatient.
Well, this is what happened. Baumgartner somehow knew von Hindenburg, and von Hindenburg drove up in this limo got out and hugged Baumgartner, so said hello to my Uncle Bill. And then von Hindenburg and Baumgartner hugged again and, you know, wept. They cried. They were reminiscing about all their relatives that died in World War One. I guess they knew they had you know, lots of relatives. And then Hindenburg pivots around and motions to this guy sitting in the back of the limousine. I'd like to introduce you to Herr Hitler. And Hitler just kind of turns and grunts.
And that was the extent of the conversation.
That's right. Just a grimace and a.
So the takeaway is that Hitler was rude.
Yeah, he was kind of rude.
Lacked social skills.
Right.
Hmm.
The takeaway from my Uncle Bill was that years later, when he joined the Navy in World War II and went through that and three terms of FDR, he recounted the story on his 94th birthday, and his takeaway from just all his life experience was that FDR was a fascist.
Ruder than Hitler? Oh, I guess both of them didn't stand up when he walked into a room. So FDR was notorious for that. If you walked into a room, he would acknowledge you, but he refused to stand up to shake your hand. So maybe
that's right.
That's a quality that fascists share.
It's rudeness, and FDR would always annoy people by saying, "We got to ramp this up."
Yeah, we're getting. The NSA is monitoring this call. That seems to be a trend. In fact, we have on the show today the directors of a documentary about just that.
FDR?
Well, men of a certain age who were Roosevelt supporters and began watching Fox News and listening to Rush Limbaugh and turned into fascists. This is not a new phenomenon.
Well, my Uncle Bill, that side of the family, see, my father had three brothers. Yeah, my dad was the only liberal in the family. And his brother Bill, my Uncle Bill, was from the part of the family that was very conservative. And they felt that FDR was a fascist and it tried to be a dictator.
Mm-hmm.
And that
was this before World War II or after?
This was during the 30s. I mean, see, my father was in the Air Force in World War II, and my Uncle Bill was in the Navy, and so they went through all three terms of FDR, and only one side of the family went very conservative. The other, I have a cousin. I think one of Uncle Bill's daughters was a speechwriter for Nixon.
What was her name?
I probably shouldn't say that over the, or, you know, so, I don't know if she'd want that out there.
Okay, so Uncle Bill was in the Navy, and he fought.
Yeah,
he fought Hitler, even though
he was mostly stationed in Alaska.
Stationed in Alaska.
Yeah, he didn't see much. He didn't see any action. My dad saw a lot of action. He bombed Japan.
My dad saw a lot of action during World War II.
I know. That's what your mom told me. I heard your dad.
I don't remember the bit. I can't remember the bit we wrote. How did it go,
I think your dad was in the CBGBs. He was in the construction corps, and he laid a lot of pipe.
The name of the documentary we're talking about is The Brainwashing of My Dad. And this goes counter to the hypothesis of the documentary, which says that AM talk radio and Fox News has taken the greatest generation, what's left of them, and turned them into fascists. But you're saying that the roots of the fascism were already there.
Yes, I believe so. I don't think the greatest generation, I mean, they came back and they perpetuated the whites only, the sundowner towns. They, you know, they did not fight for equal rights for black people or any minorities. They fought to they fought against fascism, but I don't think they even knew what the fucking fascism was for the most part. My dad did because he was an avowed liberal, but people who wanted to just get in and out of there and come back to, you know, their in my case, their rich parents' home and take over the business, it was something different.
Three brothers, only one is a liberal. According to my readings, that would make your father the baby, the youngest brother.
Yes.
Really? The theory is that the youngest son is the rebel and goes against the family tradition, whereas the oldest son is more conservative and parrots what the father has been teaching. So that is pretty much what happened, right?
Yeah, right. It was. And, you know, my grandparents, his parents were very conservative. And they were pretty racist. I remember my grandmother lived to be 95 or 96, and she would always use the N-word and talk about, but you know, she wasn't as bad racist as the current racists are.
Okay, we'll get to that in a second. Your grandmother was a pretty racist.
Yeah, but she was also an intellectual.
She was a pretty, you know? She was pretty racist.
Pretty racist. Yeah, pretty. Yeah.
And she was an intellectual.
She was a horrible racist. When I say horrible, I mean she just wasn't very good at it.
She hated white people, if I remember.
She'd always be screaming things like, "Ah, damn Syro Hittite." She was out of date. Lousy stinking Etruscans. They're always yelling out stuff in the Colosseum. I can't even hear what the gladiators are saying.
Yeah, that was a problem with the Etruscans. They always talked back at the circus.
And their lawns were just unkempt.
Very unkempt, yes. So your grandmother grew up where?
She graduated college in Bay City, Michigan. And then they moved, when she got married, they moved out to Hollywood, California in the late 20s. And my grandfather bought a bunch of land in anticipation of Hollywood people snatching it up. And he started a construction business. He sold stock right before the crash. All this kind of stuff.
So he did well.
He did well. That side of the family did.
And this would be your mother's father or your father's father?
My father's father.
Your father's father. So he came by his racism and conservatism honestly. The grandfather and the older brothers did. I mean, they were landed gentry. They weren't.
Kinda, yeah.
They weren't. They could trace their ancestry back to the Mayflower.
Before the Mayflower, they came in the 16. When was the Mayflower? They came in the 1630s.
They came in
the 40s.
Before the Mayflower.
I forget when the Mayflower was, but they were here in the 1630s, 1640s.
So they went to Virginia?
They were in Nova Scotia, and then they went back to
they were in
New York.
What, locks? They were Jewish? They imported and exported locks?
There is, I am 1/32nd Jewish.
You know, anybody who says they're 1/32nd Jewish is a raving Aryan anti-Semite. The fact that you have it narrowed down so precisely to 1/32nd Jewish.
a Jewish princess, to be exact, in Eastern Europe.
Yeah, you and a person who is making my life miserable, whose name will go unmentioned, but you know her, and very obsessed with her ancestry as well.
Who is this? I don't know who you're talking about.
So there's somebody, just somebody in my personal life who...
Your daughter.
yeah. But she's fascinated by her roots.
It's good to know where you come from, because you discover, oh, that's where I got that horrible thing from. That's why I'm such an asshole. Oh, there we go. Actually, you know, patterns of behavior are handed down from generation to generation to generation. I discovered that with tracing the my dad's surname back a few hundred years.
But I see, that to me is borderline racist.
Well, I'm talking about learned behavior, not inherited DNA.
But you're saying that, see, that's what, you know, well, here's the thing about being Jewish. Did I tell you that I'm Jewish?
Oh, Jesus.
Everything starts and stops. If you're an American Jew, everything starts and stops at Ellis Island. So we don't really, most Jews who are in America couldn't be bothered to look into their ancestry, because it's just Ellis Island. If you go back, if you go to Poland or Russia or any of those places before Ellis Island, it was just pure tragedy, rapes and pogroms and Holocaust. So people, Jewish people.
And that was a good part. And those were the holidays.
If you, you know, most Jews who live in America are not curious about anything that happened before Ellis Island. So, we live in the moment, and we think towards the future.
And well, I think it's also because it's incredibly hard to trace your records back, because they've been burned, or they're still, they haven't been released yet by most of the former Soviet occupied territories of Eastern Europe. Now they're being released, and a lot of Jewish people can actually start tracing their roots
and go, oh, so that's why they killed us. Wow, makes a little sense now. If you can trace your ancestry back to Germany, they kept really meticulous records.
Yes.
So they can tell you where you lived, where you were rounded up, or where your grandparents were rounded up.
Right.
Where they were shipped, why they were shipped, and where they were processed, and the Germans have kind of, I've said this on the show and a couple of people have been upset, but you know, the Germans have done something that America refuses to do, and that is acknowledge their past.
Right. Yeah. Absolutely. They're very, you know, the Germans had a very progressive period in the 19th century. Didn't last long.
Bismarck.
Well, yeah, kind of before Bismarck was a very militaristic.
But he invented Social Security.
Yeah. There are periods in Holland has been a model of progressive living and politics for a few hundred years, off and on. You know,
and they've
all taken responsibility for their horrors.
Their horrors. Well, let's turn to what's going on here in the United States. You know, one of the benefits to hating your family is the thought of Donald Trump becoming president doesn't seem so fearful, so frightening anymore. It's like, you know, if I'm lucky, I have another 60 years. Screw it. you know? Who says I have to leave behind a better planet? But some people actually love their families and are worried. What do you think of... I know you're a big student of Hitler. I know you're fascinated by Hitler. Well, I mean, you know, every time I've gone into your apartment, you have all the paraphernalia and the candles are lit on 420. No. On every April 20th, you celebrate his birthday.
That's not true. I don't have a lot of... I just have a lot of stuff my dad brought back from the war, souvenirs, you know, like the jawbone of a Japanese soldier, that kind of stuff.
Wait a second. Did he bring back a jawbone of a Japanese soldier?
No, I don't think it was a jawbone. I think it was a pelvis. There's a big difference.
I mean, we have a candidate running for president, Jim Earl. His name is Donald Trump, German father. Grandparents came from Germany, similar heritage of yours. He's also has a blonde mane like you. In fact,
he's got an orange mane. I don't have a blonde mane.
You have blonde hair.
Kind of, yeah.
This is what Donald Trump has said about women. He has said that he's referred to women as bimbos, dogs, and fat pigs. This is how Donald Trump talks about our mothers, our sisters, our daughters. Do you know anybody who would refer to women as bimbos, pigs, slobs? Have you ever met anybody who has talked that way about women?
And those were his compliments.
You've kind of done that kind of joke with the pugs. I don't mean to embarrass you, but... And those were his... I mean, can you imagine...
Hey, that's a callback.
Oh, okay.
I don't know anybody who would say anything like that. Wait a minute, Dave.
What?
No.
That is pretty amazing.
You're a true liberal and a progressive. You would never say anything like that about anyone.
Well, when we have a worldwide audience, so they may not be familiar with KPFK in Los Angeles, where we do our radio show. The great Greg Proops, who we know from San Francisco, walked into our studio at KPFK about 5 years ago when the show first started, and I'm talking about, you know, the Lily Bedwetter. Remember Lily Bedwetter?
Yes.
The Lily Bedwetter Act, where she wasn't being paid to wet her bed the same way a man was being paid, or she didn't get special leave to wet her. I don't know. I don't remember the Lily Bedwetter Act, but I know I was for it, and I supported Lily Bedwetter, you know, I'm pro-choice, and...
You're pro-chick.
I'm pro-chick, and yeah. Greg, we're live, and Greg Proops goes, you still keep in touch with the girls from Mills College? And I fell off the chair, and I said, please don't bring that up. Don't bring up Mills.
Dave, you have a lot of skeletons in your closet.
Yes, I do. What was Mills College?
You know, I've never been there, and I only heard about it. Somebody said it was a college that had a lot of lesbians as as students.
Well, yeah.
I don't know, you know, why that was that rumor was spread, or if it was true. I have no idea.
Well, Mills College, you and I have known each other since 1982, 1983, right?
I think 81 or 2, yeah.
Well, I moved to Berkeley in 83. And I remember meeting you with Barry Lank. And Mills College was a all-girls school in Oakland.
Mm-hmm.
They wouldn't allow men in the school. And this was the mid-80s, and we were doing morning radio, and it was ground zero for the politically correct movement. And even though I voted for Mondale and Jimmy Carter and Gary Hart, I liked to tease women who went to all-girls schools and make them cry, perhaps. We're going to on stage.
Right. Right.
It was
right.
It was a private school. I mean, it was very expensive to go to Mills College.
I did not know that.
Yeah. So Larry Brown and I used to. Anyway, just thought I'd bring up Mills. I think they allow men in there now.
Well, yeah. I guess so.
Who do you hate?
I don't know anything.
Who do you hate more? Who do you hate? You're a liberal, but who do you hate more, liberals or conservatives? Deep down in your gut. Because you went to Berkeley, right?
Yes, yes.
And you vote on the right side of history.
But after, always.
But after you've had a couple of drinks inside of you, right. Honestly, who do you hate more?
Conservatives.
No, honestly.
Conservatives.
Seriously, the people who really piss you off the most. Liberals.
Conservatives.
No, because conservatives because conservatives don't piss you off because they're ignorant. It's like getting angry at somebody who's, you know, mentally challenged. But liberals are more worthy of contempt because they're feckless and they're hypocrites and they're whiny and they're ineffectual.
I don't know how to respond to that. You know, William F. Buckley was an intellectual. Yeah. I believe there are still a lot of very intelligent conservatives out there.
No, there aren't.
Who have lost control.
No, no.
Of the conservative movement.
No, there are no intellectuals in the conservative movement. In fact, that's the subject of my interview with the directors of this documentary.
There are no active intellectuals any longer.
No, there are no active intellectuals. The Brainwashing of My Dad is a documentary that everybody should see, and we're interviewing the director on today's show. The conservative movement has zero intellectuals. What they do is they found people like William F. Buckley to give their racist John Birch ideology cover. Oh, you know, there's William F. Buckley. Most of my listeners are too young to remember William F. Buckley, who was a fascist and a racist and a homophobe, who very late in the conservative movement disassociated himself from the John Birch Society. Was, you know, he was opposed to the civil rights movement, but he learned how to use fancy words so nobody really understood what he was saying. He used, right? That was his thing.
Well, yeah, I believed he was a closeted gay.
Oh, that I can discuss that in a second with you, but...
The thing is, wasn't your father a proud John Bircher girl?
Yes, he was.
Just like Hillary Clinton was a proud Goldwater girl.
But there are no intellectuals in the conservative movement. There are
not any longer.
There never were. They were always just PR people for the Chamber of Commerce, for industry. But there was no, you know. So that's why I hate liberals more than I hate conservatives. Because you can't get mad at stupid people.
Yeah, you can.
All right.
Sure you can.
Who are you voting for? Bernie or Hillary?
Bernie. If it gets here.
Why are they, is Trump, is he just going to shut down?
Well, you know, if Bernie doesn't drop out before the California primary.
And what happens, this is my thinking on Bernie. Everything he says is right. I agree with him 100%, and I have to vote for him. But I'm worried, God forbid, he actually gets the nomination and he goes up against Trump, then both sides will have been perceived to have had nervous breakdowns.
Why would our side have a nervous breakdown?
Because there's no truth anymore in our discourse and everything, you know, the false equivalency that the media narrative insists upon, so that even though Bernie Sanders is dealing with reality and the truth and is honest and actually knows how to pass legislation, they will say the Democratic Party is having a crack up not seen since George McGovern. And then all of a sudden, Donald Trump is going to seem moderately reasonable, because what's going to happen is Donald Trump is going to lock up the nomination, and every one of the fascists who were running against him will fall in line. And you will have a united party in Cleveland. I guarantee you that come the convention, the Republicans will fall in line.
Oh, yeah, I bet they will. You know, he's gonna lock up, Trump is going to lock up the nomination and then lock up all the Jews.
Sold. Okay, now I'm voting for him. Yeah, what happens? I mean,
I can't believe, you know, this. I can't believe Carson says his campaign's finished.
Carson? He died in 2005.
No, the other Carson. Yeah.
Kit Carson?
I can't believe Carson. I don't believe Carson's finished with his campaign. I bet he left a sponge in there somewhere.
Yeah.
And it's not too late. It's not too late. Here's my other Bush joke.
Oh, good.
This is a Bush joke. It's not too late for Bush to force a feeding tube down his campaign's throat.
That would be Mary Schiavo reference?
Yeah, that's a Mary Schiavo reference.
She was great in bed, wasn't she? I wouldn't. Hang on.
I wouldn't know. That's a very sexist comment to make.
Hang on. Here's my Mary Schiavo joke. Are you ready?
Sure, go ahead.
Okay. I wouldn't. Mary Schiavo is very beautiful. I wouldn't kick her out of bed for taking liquefied crackers through a feeding tube.
That's a very interesting joke.
Let me explain that, because normally the joke would be I wouldn't kick her out of bed for eating crackers.
Right.
But
right.
You got to
liquefy the crackers for Terry Schiavo, however.
Yes. You know, people are very stupid. Did you know that?
No, I did not know that. Please explain, Dave.
I was on a show, I won't mention any names, and I said I thought I had diarrhea, but it turns out I swallowed a Cuisinart.
Uh-huh.
Now, that joke tracks, right?
It tracks, and not only tracks, it rocks. You know what? You know how to brand your content in this new media ecosystem.
Wow.
How many followers do you have on this podcast? How many listeners?
Well, it's been a while since we had you on the show.
Yeah, yeah. Is it still the same show? There's so many incarnations of the show.
I know.
You know, it's like the Smothers Brothers show. It goes from the summer replacement hour to the Glenn Stevens, or I don't know.
It's like, I'm like Bowie.
Only without the talent or the appeal?
Mm-hmm. Through, I think, is the word. Done. Finished. Dead.
Done.
No, but the show, I think we were like over 1,200 episodes. At one point, you and I, Steve Rosenfeld, and
Field,
whatever, and Eddie Pepitone did a sitcom in front of a live audience, and it was magnificent.
It was great.
It was just one of the greatest things that was ever done in any. It really was. You were the band leader. Eddie was the sidekick, and you and I had a relationship like Clyde Tolson and J. Edgar Hoover. Like we slept in the same bed, but we refused to say we were gay.
Right, right.
It was hysterical. We just thought it was perfectly normal for a host and his band leader to sleep in the same bed. But you started getting pissed off. Remember, we had fights. We would put you in dresses on a radio show. And you thought it was undignified. I remember
No, that was the character.
No.
I just thought like the fifth episode where you're doing I'm caught in a dress joke. I just thought, hey, maybe we should move on to another joke. You know?
I have to dig those up and play them because they really are some of the funniest. I remember Robin came to one and you and I were talking about lube tasting in the lube country.
I forgot that. No.
It was great. Rick Overton. Everybody did that show. Well, Memory Lane.
Yeah. Jeff who? Gardner?
What's Jeff Garland, Patton Oswalt, yeah. Mark Moron. Yeah. Do you know I was the first person ever to call him Mark Moron?
I don't know about that.
Yeah,
fact checkers.
No, I called that. him when he moved to San Francisco. I said, you're Mark Moron. And he said to me, you know, I went through public school education and nobody ever said that I was Mark Moron. You're the first person ever to call me Mark Moron. He wouldn't be sarcastic. He doesn't do sarcasm, right?
I think he was being sarcastic.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Morning Remembrances? How can people buy that?
Oh, you mean my book of funny and real obituaries, mm-hmm, of real people?
Hey, the inventor of email died.
I know. I'm trying to write that right now.
Do you have a joke?
No, I don't. You know, sometimes the most obvious candidates have absolutely no real jokes to them, except maybe one, and that's it.
And
like, you know.
And the Clutter family, are they still together?
Off and on. We do some practicing, come up with some new songs. Right. Yeah.
Well, before we go, we have time for my fan mail because I have to do the fan mail segment on the show. Jim, the show is really taking off and people go to davidfeldmanshow.com and there's a contact button and women fall in love with a man's voice. I don't know what it is. But just women,
Oh, then you better find one.
Well, I got here. So let me just read some. It's always women, Jim. This comes to us from Janet Robertson. Subject is, she wants to be fucked. Hey, make me today. I will never ask you for dates, money, or attention. Just fuck me a couple of times. How much do you attract me so much? Just look at this. Stop hesitating and pay me a visit. Well, Janet, thank you very much, but it would be unethical. I think there are FCC rules prohibiting me from hooking up with my fans, but we're going to send you a T-shirt. Thank you for that. This one is from...
I think Janet was probably very attracted by your commentary on the situation in Palestine.
Yes. This is from Hope Shelton, let's go wild, she says. We do so many topics on this show, Jim, about the economy and the elections, but the women, I just make them hot. So Hope Shelton, subject, let's go wild. Hi, it's an urgent hookup message. Do you really care what hypocrites will say? Drill my pussy all night long. This is my address, already missing you. Well, Hope, again, there's no need to miss me. You can just listen to our podcast on iTunes. And again, I don't care what hypocrites say. I'm a liberal, and the hypocrites are found in the Republican Party, and we're going to send you a T-shirt. But thank you very much for the offer, but I really cannot have sex with my listeners. This comes from Whitney Wong.
No, Dave, may I make a comment on your
yes?
Your opinion? You've always been against... You've always been against allowing more drilling of pussies,
right? Yes,
but you're in favor of fracking them.
Do you know that queefs are the number one source of greenhouse gases?
Well, I do now.
Whitney Wong writes.
Whitney Wong
is her name, W-O-N-G, and the subject is three pending a fast sex hookup call. Whitney writes, I'm just looking for a cute guy to hook up with, want to see my pics and chat. I feel so sexy and horny right now. That's what I do. She's obviously listening to my show And are you available to chat? And she's sending me pictures. Talk soon. Whitney, again, thank you for listening. And we're going to send you a T-shirt. But I just cannot date my listeners. It's inappropriate. Snap-on dentures for seniors. This comes from Cleo. She says, look your best for the spring season. Shop denture offers sure to make you smile. And their smiles are available, and she's offering me Snap-on dentures, which, you know what? Is it, Alex, is it wrong for me to take gifts from people on the, who, I'm sorry, is that payola? I mean, I'm not endorsing these Snap-on dentures, but boy, that, you know what? I think
you could have a franchise of Snap-on dentures.
Yeah. Have you ever heard of vagina dentata?
Heard of it. I live it.
What is vagina dentata?
It's kind of like when you cook a vagina and you just you don't cook it too long. Too long.
That's vagina al dente. You're thinking.
Oh, whoops.
Yeah. Which is, you know, it's just, that is great for pasta puttanesca. With a side, do you know what why they call it pasta puttanesca?
Because it's you put your hot gnocchi in it.
Do you speak Italian?
Yeah, I speak Italian now. that's a fine watermelon, eh, boss?
I would think Snap-on dentures would be good for somebody who wanted to pretend to have vagina dentata. But we have to wrap it up, Jim. We should do this more often. This was great.
I can't believe we're ending on the vagina dentata bit.
Vagina dentata. Wasn't that from The Lion King?
Thank God, I give up.
Okay. All right. Jim Earl, how do people reach you to complain about this show?
They can reach me on jimearl.com or they can just yell out into a parking lot where I'll be sleeping.
Dear Lord. Thank you, Jim.